My name is Martin Gibala. I'm a professor and chair of the Department of Kinesiology at McMaster University in Ontario, Canada. I took part in the debate, Exercise for Health, Does Intensity Matter? And I presented the pro side of the debate, suggesting that intensity does play a role in the health adaptations that we see with exercise. The evidence that I promoted was from a number of laboratories, including observational studies, collected, for example, on 5,000 individuals who cycled in the city of Copenhagen. There's a large-scale prospective study there called the Copenhagen Heart Study. And these individuals, when they were recruited into the study, were asked about their subjective or relative cycling habits. Did they exercise for less than 30 minutes a day, 30 minutes to an hour a day, or more than an hour a day? And in addition to that, would they rate themselves as a relatively slow cyclist, an average cyclist, or a fast cyclist compared to those around them? And these individuals were followed for a period of up to 20 years. And what they found at the end of the study was that the fast cyclists, on average, lived about 6 years longer if they were a man, and about 3.5 years longer if they were a woman. And on top of that, they tended to have reduced risk for cardiovascular disease, less died of coronary heart disease, and lower risk for type 2 diabetes, as well as serum triglycerides. So at least some observational evidence that suggested that intensity is important. And the overall conclusion was that from that study was, if you're going to be cycling around, it's better to do brisk cycling as opposed to cycling at a pedestrian pace. In addition to that, there's a number of randomized control trials that have been done, most of them conducted in Trondheim, Norway, that have been conducted on individuals with metabolic syndrome, those with coronary artery disease, coronary heart disease, obese individuals. And these have been relatively small-scale RCTs, usually having only about 10 or 15 subjects in each group. But what they've attempted to do is try and match the total amount of exercise that people perform, either at a high-intensity pace or at a more moderate intensity pace that tends to be reflective of traditional public health guidelines. The intense exercise is performed in an interval manner, which means people exercise briskly for a couple of minutes, then take a break, and then repeat that pattern a couple of times. So in these studies, the typical high intensity interval training exercise has lasted for about 40 minutes, and the work matched or volume matched continuous exercise has been about 47 minutes. And across a series of studies, the main outcomes have been that the physiological adaptations that they see in terms of maximal aerobic capacity or cardiorespiratory fitness are higher in the interval training group compared to the continuous moderate intensity group. In addition, measures of vascular function, for example, endothelial function or flow-mediated dilation, tends to be higher in the interval training group, and markers of the oxidative capacity of muscle, such as mitochondrial content, tends to be higher in the interval training groups as well. And they, when they measure a number of health-related parameters, things like insulin sensitivity, typically just using HOMA scores based on fasting insulin and glucose, those tend to be higher in the interval training group as well. So the upshot from those studies is that both types of training improve the situation compared to a control group, but the interval training group showed superior adaptations. And there's been some recent meta-analyses that have tried to obviously look at all of these studies together, and the general conclusions have been the same as from the individual studies. So that would be some of the best evidence. In addition, there's been some smaller scale interval training studies that have compared relatively small amounts of high intensity interval training versus a relatively large total volume of traditional moderate intensity training. So if the other studies that I was referring to was taking an apples to apples comparison, where the same amount of total exercise was done in the two groups, this other category of studies that I'm talking about would be an apples to oranges approach, where you're comparing a relatively small total amount of interval training versus a relatively large amount of traditional endurance training. And what those studies, a number of them conducted in our laboratory, have shown is that despite these fairly significant differences in the total amount of exercise that people are performing and the total time commitment, we see very similar adaptations between the two groups. We've even done a short-term study in people who have type 2 diabetes and showed that the improvements in their fitness levels and the reductions in their blood sugar levels were quite pronounced and similar to what we see with longer traditional endurance type training. So these are only small proof of principle studies. We're not ready at all to scrap the public health guidelines or suggest anything like that, but I think a little bit of evidence in support of my case that intensity of exercise can play a role. Of course, health means many different things. There's physical attributes, there's mental attributes, there's psychosocial attributes, and in any one study, we're never going to capture all of these determinants of health, but hopefully through the debate, I tried to shed some evidence or some light on the fact that, at least in my mind, intensity does play a role in the adaptations that we see with exercise training for health. Thank you.